Hello friends, welcome back to the channel. And today's video is going to be a very important one. Since the budget was presented, 90% of the people who own, you know, two strokes or vintage category vehicles or vehicles which are more than 15 years old are slightly worried. So this is a very important video in that respect. So I'm trying to clear out some of the confusions. Apart from that, I also want to, you know, try to be as objective as possible to help you understand this new law and how it may impact a common person who, you know, owns a vehicle or multiple vehicles which are older than 15 years old. First things first. So like you can see in the video, this is a dash cam video. And this video is from a Zen which is 16 year old, and I had restored the Zen from almost ground up. So I did underbody coating, I actually painted the whole car, changed the complete interiors, then, you know, I got new radiator, I replaced the entire suspension, I put four brand new tires. So the money that I bought this car for was, you know, literally doubled, or, you know, the amount of money that I have tied up in this car literally doubled the moment I started doing work on this. And now, you know, this car looks like almost a brand new car and also performs like one. But the point is, even though if I have a vehicle which is clean, which is not polluting, which is not creating noise pollution, which is not affecting other people, you know, this rule might still be impacting me in some way or the other. So that is one of the questions that most of the people have in their mind. So to give you a small perspective, you know, I am basically from Kerala and I have lived my entire life in Delhi, and I moved to Kerala in 2010. Before, you know, leaving Delhi, I briefly stayed couple of years in Hyderabad. So I have stayed majorly in these three cities, and I have also spent close to 6 to 7 months in Chennai. So I'll give you a perspective of the kind of vehicles or the condition of vehicles that you see in these cities. Okay, so if you are from Delhi, you are pretty familiar that all of the vehicles will have pretty bad bodywork. So even, you know, a brand new vehicle will have a lot of scratches on it. And that is one of the most major problem in Delhi. But when you come to places like Hyderabad, they have open roads, so vehicles are a little bit better maintained. But when you look at outskirts of Delhi, when you look at NCR, when you look at you know, places in Haryana, places in UP, you will notice that the quality of vehicle not just deteriorates exponentially, but it also, you know, most of the vehicles are in pretty bad condition. They are not fit to be on the road, to be honest. So, you know, this policy is definitely aimed at taking those vehicles off the road. However, you have to understand one primary thing. A budget is basically to talk about expenses. It is usually to talk about finances, it is to talk about the planning of finances for an entire fiscal. It talks about how the government is going to give, you know, a push to various sectors which are going down. So it's a very finance oriented thing. You know, it's not something which would aim at improving the environment. It might have a component which we'll talk about. Okay, we are going to spend this kind of money for the environment, but you know, this cannot be a topic which would be a center topic. You know, this would be a subtopic. But in yesterday's budget, this was presented in such a way that this is going to, you know, really make a difference in the environment. We are going to get to breathe clean air, and, you know, the sales will improve. So there are a couple of things that I principally disagree with in this particular case. So one of those thing is obviously you know, the way this is getting implemented. So first of all, we have to understand that, you know, people in the country have been reeling under some really badly made decisions. Okay, so I'm not going to talk in such a way that I might sound like somebody who's trying to promote an agenda or who's trying to, you know, demean what the government is doing. So that is not my intent. My intent is to see things objectively. Okay, so the first impact that came in this present government, this is the second tenure of the government, but the first impact came in the terms of currency ban. So when the currency ban happened, a large portion of the GDP was wiped clean. Okay, people didn't have money. So to give you a small example, you know, there are, you know, scrap vendors who actually buy scrap from local, you know, people who collect scrap from home at a small premium than what these guys pay to the homeowners. And then this is, you know, segregated into different kind of scrap. You know, there might be copper, there might be steel, there might be stainless steel. So it is all segregated and then it is sent to various processing units across India. So what has happened essentially is the person who used to collect scrap from each house has to have money to pay these homeowners. So, you know, these guys didn't have liquid cash. So they stopped collecting scraps. They, you know, held on to whatever money they had. They, you know, some of them went back to their home somehow. So the note ban actually impacted the sector very disproportionately. So from a salaried perspective, you might not have seen a huge difference, but things did change for people. So in a single night, a complete industry was uprooted. Like, you know, to give you an example, there are small scale industries in parts of Tamil Nadu. Let me take a specific example of industries in Coimbatore, which actually winds motors. Okay, so these guys had to shut shop because they didn't have money to buy raw material. They didn't have, you know, their sales went down, people were jobless, so they didn't have money to pay their you know, employees. So things kind of went really horrible for the economy. As you are aware, that 2% of the GDP was cleanly wiped. So these things, you know, we were kind of coming out of that impact. That is when GST came in. So when the GST came in, you know, people started getting impacted again. So there was a huge confusion initially. Nobody had clarity. You know, there are people who had initially paid close to 18% GDP for eating food, and then it was reduced to 5%. So there was a lot of confusion. And because of all this, whole industry is kind of were wiped out. Then the next thing that came after this was, you know, something that affected the whole world. But, you know, I was reading some comments on certain Facebook forums, and I could see that people were clearly saying that India has aced the way, you know, Corona was handled. India kind of managed it really well. And, you know, if you look at US or you look at Italy, you know, India kind of had lesser number of death compared to what US and Italy had. See, to tell you very honestly, you know, the coronavirus actually didn't catch a bus or a train, or for that matter a boat or a ship, to reach India. It came through air. Okay, there are only a few airports which actually had people coming from these regions. So if it was completely sealed properly, then probably we won't have even, you know, the number of deaths that we had right now. So, you know, those are loved ones, you know, people who you used to sit and have food with are gone all of a sudden. So, you know, let's say you had a grandfather or a grandmother who, you know, was part of your family, who you used to have dinner and lunch together with, her no more because of this pandemic. You know, in early February, when the first set of corona cases came to India, Kerala had already gone ahead and declared it as a national calamity. And, you know, because of that, they were able to plan things ahead, well ahead, and things were in control. But then there were, you know, huge events that were recklessly planned, like, you know, the Namaste Trump that happened, because of which, you know, lakhs of people came from different parts of the world, and there was absolutely no control. And, you know, I remember seeing clips wherein people were stranded for hours in various airports, you know, people disappearing after they were asked to quarantine. So all these things happened, but this could have been avoided properly, and it could have been planned properly. Another biggest blunder that happened during this time was, you know, the actual lockdown that was implemented in a 4-hour notice. You know, I remember my cruise at that time was at the service center. I was getting, you know, a periodic maintenance happening on the cruise, and I didn't know that such a thing is going to happen. And then partially at the same time, my Zen was borrowed by a friend, so I didn't have any other vehicle at home at that time, cars, and the only bike which was rideable at that time was the RD350. So I actually went to the grocery shop, bought the groceries, put it on the tank, like, you know, one of those uncles who ride these you know, vintage bikes with all their family, everybody sitting on a single bike. It was like that for me. And, you know, though it was funny, but I saw terrible things happen to people. You know, people were walking barefoot from Bangalore to, you know, places like Assam and all, you know, 1400-1500 kilometers, families walking, because all of a sudden it was so unplanned that people just simply didn't know what to do. Okay, so see, basically people say that, you know, it is to contain the spread of COVID, but you have to understand that, you know, these people have nowhere to go. If it was planned properly, if there were buses, if there were, you know, proper arrangements made, these people would have still gone. So like the buses that started after a couple of weeks, the Shramik trains which came after a couple of weeks, this could have done planned in advance to, you know, prevent the chaos that happened. So similarly, you know, I gave all this example to let you know how this policy is in shape. So right now they are definitely saying that this is going to be a completely voluntary policy. So if, let's say, your vehicle has a 15-year, you know, fitness, and then probably after another 5 years, you would have to pay additional green tax that would actually be a lot more, more than what you're paying right now. And that would really beat the purpose of owning a vehicle which is beyond a certain age. So the point is, you know, places like US and, you know, Europe, those places have a voluntary scrappage policy. People, you know, do change their vehicle every 3 years, 4 years. People don't usually tend to keep their vehicles longer. You know, long-term ownership is very rare amongst the common people in US, unless and until it's an exotic vehicle like a Mustang or maybe, you know, a Ferrari. So these vehicles stay with the owner, but other vehicles which are common, like the Corollas, the Hondas, these things are something which people flip every 3-4 years. So similarly in UK also this happens, but, you know, these things are not just dismantled and taken for parts. These are actually shipped to poorer countries like Africa, you know, places like Middle East. So these vehicles are not, you know, gone out of this planet. They are still polluting some part of the planet. Okay, so that is the voluntary policy in the developed nations. Okay, so what they are doing is they are just making sure that their air is clean, their shores are clean, but, you know, they are going to different countries. Like, you know, to give you an example, China used to import tons of plastic waste from US, UK, but one fine day they decided that they are not going to do this, and all of a sudden plastic became a huge problem in US and UK. So similarly, right now US and UK or other European countries or other developed countries have an opportunity to ship their, there is an industry which ship their old and junk cars to, you know, different part of the world where they are used by poorer countries. Okay, so similarly in India, there are, you know, people who might not be able to afford a brand new car. And, you know, to be honest, a brand new car doesn't make business sense, because the moment you buy a car, you actually had to face depreciation. So something that somebody might buy for, let's say, 15, 20 lakhs might be available for 5 to 7 lakhs in 3 years. So that's a huge loss. So common man doesn't really, you know, think about it. And they usually tend to keep their vehicles longer. So, you know, in my case, I was actually planning to upgrade my cruise last year. I was thinking that I might want to go to the next, you know, segment of cars, and I wanted to experience something more premium than the cruise. But I had stopped my decision because of the, you know, economic situation. You know, people do say that the GDP is reduced, but they don't know how it affects you. You know, things get expensive, like, you know, petrol and diesel are at all-time high. So these things tend to become so expensive that a common person cannot really afford to keep or, you know, buy a new car. So they usually keep their old cars. They try to, you know, make small fixes. So I was initially talking about different part of countries where I've lived. So in Kerala, usually people tend to keep their vehicles more nicely. Like, you know, they are mechanically fit. These guys restore their vehicles properly. They keep their vehicles like a family member. But the situation is not very same, let's say, in Delhi. Delhi people use it, and then, you know, these are considered as disposable vehicles and they go. So, you know, similarly in, let's say, Karnataka, or let's say Hyderabad, and, you know, let's say Tamil Nadu and Chennai, people usually tend to keep their vehicles little longer. You know, unlike Delhi, where one segment, the rich segment, actually buys a new car after 3-4 years, they, you know, pass on the depreciation to maybe a business that they have, and they buy another new car. So this keeps happening. But now you have to understand, the cars are not the same that used to be about 10, 15, 20 years ago. You know, those cars were built to last. You know, I have vintage bikes. You know, right now, I have bikes which are over 35, 36 years old. They still, you know, look and, you know, ride like a new bike because they were built to last. You know, you compare a Pulsar 220 or a Duke 390 with an RD 350. Let's see after 5 years which bike will still, you know, stand the test of time. So, you know, usually vehicles are not built better anymore. They are built to be disposable at some point in time. There are a lot of cheating that vehicle manufacturers do. Like, you know, you must be aware of the famous Dieselgate that happened with Volkswagen, wherein they had manipulated their diesel vehicles completely. And, you know, these kind of things are very common. Manufacturers are not in a loss because of, you know, just because of sales in India. It's a global thing. You know, globally, the sales have come down. They are in losses. Companies are shutting down a lot of their initial or, you know, major segments. They are moving to cleaner fuel like electricity. So, you know, this is basically a push, or rather, you know, a pull from the market, which is causing them to shift, not just, you know, them adopting to cleaner technologies because they believe in making the earth greener. Of course, there are, you know, now these companies have to have a carbon footprint, they have to control their carbon footprint, so those things are also important. But at the same time, these guys are in loss because people are not buying their cars anymore. You know, people globally do not feel that it makes sense to actually buy a new car. They rather decide to keep their existing cars for a little longer. So we have had a very long off-topic discussion to, you know, just talk about the general psyche. But now I'm coming to the main topic, which is the scrappage policy. So I've already done a video on the scrappage policy, and I've kind of explained the situation. But right now, the scrappage policy is just being brought in to push the automotive sector, and it has absolutely nothing to do with the environment. Okay, so that is like the, you know, when the note ban happened, they said, okay, this will promote digital payment, this would make sure the income tax base rises, more people will come under the direct tax basis. So all those things, you know, even there are multiple goalposts in this policy as well. This policy is not at all to, you know, especially when it comes to be presented in a budget, this is not aimed at protecting the environment, making sure that the earth is habitable for the next generations to come. So, you know, that is not what the aim is. The aim is to give a push to the automotive sector, which has been lobbying the government for a very long time to make sure that they bring such a law so that people in India start buying cars and start, you know, scrapping their old cars more. So this is more of a cultural thing in India, that people tend to keep their car longer than, you know, other parts of the world. So basically this is a lobby which is playing to do this. Now about the policy. The policy says that it's a voluntary policy. So first of all, that means that, you know, let's say you have a vehicle parked at home, even let's say it is rotting, the government cannot come and, you know, seize your vehicle just because it is not roadworthy. So if it is inside your property, it is not plying on public roads, that would not mean that these vehicles would be seized. Now, the second important thing that you have to understand is each vehicle is an asset. It has a ownership document. So people who have these documents can keep them as assets. The only thing is you won't be able to drive it on roads, which is a second topic. We'll come to that. But, you know, nobody is going to take your vehicle and scrap it. It's again voluntary. They are saying that they will give some perks in terms of road tax cuts. But trust me, you know, road tax is not something that directly goes to the center. States have a cut in that. So states have to decide. They have to agree upon saying that, okay, we are ready to do road tax cuts. Now, the second point is shifting towards cleaner energy. Okay, right now in India, 95% of the power is generated through thermal power. So most of it is either coal driven or fossil fuel, like, you know, natural gas and other like naphtha, those kind of things is what drives these power plants. So obviously, let's say if you are thinking that your Tata Nexon EV is making sure that, you know, it is spreading green miles, then you are absolutely wrong, because the power that you are generating for charging that Tata Nexon EV, or let's say the Tesla EV which is to come, is generated through dirty fuel. So you are not going to save the environment. Okay, now if the government actually gives you an opportunity to do an engine swap legally, you know, let's say you have an old Jeep which has an old Matador engine which is producing a lot of carbon and it is not at all efficient. If the government actually gives you a legal option to put a brand new engine in it, that would mean a lot of people will do that. Okay, and if it is endorsable in the RC, people will do that. Now again, the next thing that the government is saying is this would boost jobs, this would increase sector. See, first of all, in this budget they increased import taxes on a lot of things. So when that happens, raw material will have to be manufactured in the country to take that benefit. Otherwise, companies will face difficulties. But the point that one of the entrepreneurs, basically Rahul Bajaj, made is, you know, it is still profitable to import raw materials from China, even though there is high import tax. So India as a country has to reach a point wherein, you know, importing these things has to be more expensive than manufacturing it domestically, and the benefit has to be passed to the customer. It's not like the benefit, it's always like, you know, everything goes to the government coffers and nothing trickles down to the common man. So that is what has been happening so far. Another very important thing, during Corona, people are heavily relied on, you know, private transport. They are heavily relied on their own vehicles. So if you notice, all used car values have gone up. You know, a Yamaha RX-100 before Corona was available for 35,000-45,000. Now it's almost close to a lakh. RX-135 5 speeds are close to 1.5 lakhs. I'm just giving you examples of vehicles that, you know, we keep on looking on OLX. And then there are a lot of new drivers who have hit the roads. So overall, people are not comfortable taking the public transport. So generally what has happened is the used car values have gone up. But now what is going to happen is people who, you know, have bought these used cars, who have their renewals coming up in a couple of months, will be little upset. They will be little scared. So, you know, since yesterday I've been getting numerous messages on Instagram, bro, is the, are our bikes going to be, you know, banned completely? Would we get fitness for those? So those kind of questions are there in everybody's mind. So, you know, this is a huge problem. You know, this is a huge confusion that the government has created right now by rolling out such a rule in haste. They are saying that, you know what, we will have a policy in place. There will be automated testing centers which will test the, you know, fitness of your vehicle. People are also saying, you know, in UK, US, they do MOT testing every year, and if the vehicle doesn't clear, then they have to fix it and bring it, do the MOT again. If it fails multiple times, then it is destined for the scrapyard. All those things happen in a developed country. Their public transport infrastructure is exemplary. You know, it's not like what we are used to. Our public transport is horrible. You know, most of the buses that run in Kerala are, you know, over 15, 20 years old. So first thing which is going to happen if the scrappage policy comes is all those buses will go off-road. So right now, the already struggling road transport corporation will go under. You know, they will have to buy new buses. You know, things will drastically change. So these things are going to impact common men. The taxes will go up. You know, they will have to buy, you know, tickets to travel. The ticket prices will go up because they have to buy new vehicles. So this is going to affect common man who's still relying on public transport. Everybody cannot pay, let's say, 100 bucks for, you know, a distance of 5 to 10 kilometers on an auto rickshaw. So people are still relying on transport. So this is very ill-timed. Now, another very important thing that I have to tell you is, most of you guys must have noticed, but might not have analyzed this, the fuel prices right now are at a whole time, you know, high in India. In Delhi, it has almost, petrol is almost 100 rupees a liter. This government has actually gone ahead and increased the taxes, the excise duty on petrol and diesel, so much that excise duty was the only form of tax which saw a spike during the lockdown period. But rest of the taxes, like, you know, goods and services taxes, value added taxes and income tax saw a big decline. But the, you know, it's funny that this particular tax actually kept on, you know, spiking. Right now the tax component is very high. See, if Sri Lanka and Nepal, who buy petrol and diesel, refined petrol and diesel from us, can still sell it under 60 rupees a liter and make a profit and still make sure that the money goes for their, you know, maintenance of their roads and, you know, amenities for their citizens, I don't think, you know, India is doing any justice or anything good by increasing the fuel prices to an exorbitant level. So right now, to be honest, managing a car, be it new or old, is almost impossible. You know, right now, options for buying a good, reliable, or, you know, car, value for money car have gone down big time. You know, you do not have those cars which used to cost like 12 to 13 lakhs and give you a feel of a car which is, you know, close to 17 to 18 lakhs. So things have changed now. Things have gone very expensive. It is very expensive to maintain it. It's very expensive to run it daily due to rising fuel costs. So it's a sector which is, you know, kind of facing a huge disruption. You know, people kind of hailed big time when they heard that there is going to be subscription services, cars are going to be you know, available for monthly subscription. You don't have to pay EMI, you don't have to worry about insurance, you don't have to worry about maintenance. Let me burst your bubble. You know, there are companies who haven't paid refunds to customers for almost 6 to 8 months now. So that is what is going to happen. You know, the whole sector is down. And it is not going to be revived just because, you know, somebody is going to put a gun on your head and say that you scrap your car. Another important thing is, though this policy says it is voluntary, though this policy says that everything is good, you know, it is aimed at ensuring that the common man or the user gets the maximum benefit, it is absolutely not true. This actually gives another way for the system to harass people. You know, right now you will see cops catching you more just because your vehicle is more than 15 years old. They will ask you one more document. You know, you won't believe how much the vehicle insurance has gone up. See, in the year 2016, when I bought my Cruise, at that time a comprehensive insurance at that very time was around 12,000 rupees. Right now third party insurances are 10,000 rupees. You know, that is the kind of hike it has seen. People's salary is not going up, people's expenses are not going down. You know, things are very bad. Right now the government should actually focus on resurrecting the economy rather than giving shocks like this. You know, if people start selling vehicles, people are not going to buy vehicles at the same time. You know, for the first time in the history of mankind, in the month of April, the auto sector had zero sales. Okay, so that has happened, and the sales has not picked up to the levels which has been in the previous years. Okay, so sales are pretty horrible, everything is bad. So right now the economy doesn't need another shock. You know, it doesn't need another note ban, it doesn't need another GST, it doesn't need another lockdown, it doesn't need a vehicle scrappage policy. That's my personal take on it. I might have taken a lot of time trying to open up my heart, but whatever I have said has directly come from my heart. This is my personal opinion. So people who beg to differ with it, I understand. You know, we touched upon almost all aspects of it, I hope. So, you know, if you guys still feel that, you know, you agree with the government, or if you feel that you agree with me, then do feel free to share this video. I know this video is pretty lengthy, so people might not see the whole video, but somewhere around 19 minutes is where I start talking about this policy. So this policy right now is not out in the whole form. So right now they are saying that they will have automated testing centers. If they don't, then that would create another avenue for bribes. And by the way, India ranked as the 80th worst country in the world which takes a lot of bribes. So that is another achievement, another milestone that we hit yesterday. So this will create more bribe. You know, you will have to rely more on RTO agents, you will have to rely more on paying bribe to the, you know, motor vehicle department to get your vehicles registered without much of hassle. So all that is going to happen. I hope some sense prevails in the government and government wakes up and starts thinking about the common man who has been paying for building toilets since 2015 when the petrol prices started going up. You know, so my request to the government is, if you have done building toilets, please go ahead and give us a breather. Let us also enjoy a little bit of lesser up price for the fuel. Let's also start using our cars more so that people aspire to buy better cars, so that, you know, the economy gains. So, you know, this is not the right approach. This approach is definitely going to scare people more, and people are not going to purchase their new cars, because if people know that their cars are going to be worthless after 15 years, people are not going to invest in cars. They will tend to use expensive mode of transports, like, you know, public transport or some other mode. But people are not going to buy cars if you put a gun on their head. So kindly understand, make sure that, you know, you start thinking about people. We definitely need policies which would stimulate the economy, but these policies are totally unthought of. These have created chaos. People are searching for more answers on this policy. The entire automotive forums in Facebook are talking about this particular thing. So this is not going to be easy. So I hope some sense prevails in the government and government takes some action and, you know, changes the perception amongst people and makes some amendments so that things go well, roads are better, fuels are not adulterated, you know, cheaper fuel is available, cleaner fuel is available, vehicle maintenance cost goes down, unnecessarily overcharging, you know, on parts stops. So that is my humble request to the government. I hope, you know, somewhere somebody is listening, and I hope this video might have struck a chord with you. If it did, please like, share and subscribe. Thanks a lot. Have a great day ahead. Bye-bye.